all you had to do is not be able to mute Peter, and it's just love, and like the optimism is flowing this morning.
Is that a dig?
Dude, that's a positive statement. There is no dig. A dig would have been like...
No. Pedro! Yeah, Pedro, yeah.
Bitcoin, I was kind of lost. I didn't, even when this kind of thing happened, I didn't really know where to go. There was no warm blanket. There was no cocoon. There was nothing that I own. I'm going to go back to unconfiscatability again. If you own your own, if you have your own keys, you own the damn thing. It's the only thing I've owned in my entire life. It's the only thing that I can actually trust. It's based on math. It's mine. Nobody can tell me what to do with it. And so when things like that happen in the political world, I can then kind of sit back and go, you know what? I have Bitcoin.
Okay, Happy New Year 2024. 4Bs are back. We have Bold Dildo up there. We have the traffic cone down here. And that's it. We don't have So Never Look. We don't have Mrs. No Show. But we do have a pumping Bitcoin price, hence the hoodie. Nice Bitcoin orange. And you've got a podcast, even though we're full of flu. So
Never Look's been taken out like the Christmas disease from his children. Obviously, Chris is about sharing. His children shared it with him, took him down. No doubt he'll be listening tomorrow from his deathbed, enjoying it, whatever bullshit would come up today. But like you said, pumping price, interesting news out at the moment. That kind of like what we're teetering on the edge of the ETF now. We've got the bits about Millet going on at the moment. So you've got all these interesting bits and pieces here, there and everywhere. It's going to be a very interesting year, isn't it?
It is. Yeah, it's. We've even got fucking Jim Cramer. You know, you shared the link in our group. I nearly added it to the agenda because he's obviously been a huge naysayer, been loving it the last 2 years. Obviously, he was part of the original pump. He jumped on the bandwagon when we were going up to 69k, thinking, you know, this is it. And then we dumped and suddenly you flipped and went, nah, it's a Ponzi, fuck this. And it's like, oh great, you know, Cramer's obviously is a reverse indicator, whatever he says the opposite will happen. And then and unfortunately today's come out going, oh, Bitcoin's back, it's probably never going to die. So unfortunately it probably means that's the end of this little pump, because Cramer's now getting on board with it. But it just shows even the worst of our haters.
They're saying it's back, aren't they? They're saying it's back. It never went away.
I know.
You look at the chart, and what's really interesting. So if you zoom out for 5 years to basically take in the last cycle, and you've got, I think it's probably up to about October, November, you've got a slight little hump. You've got a dip. When is it? 13th of March, 2020. And then it kind of goes up. It goes up a little bit. And then you hit about November, October, and it looks like it's going up. And then you've got the big bit where it goes up over 2 months and it flies up from, what is it, about 15 to about 45 or so. And it's like, you look at what we're doing now and it looks like we're about October in that cycle. That's what the similarity is. So the halving was, when was that? That was it March 2020?
I think it was May. It's going to be similar again. I think it's May again this year.
Yeah. So it's just, if you look at the pattern, I know it's patterns, and you go with what do we have with that guy who was predicting the price and it got blown out of the water?
Plan B.
Yeah, Plan B. You just can't follow these price predictions, but you just look at the similarities because there's halvings, There's the hype. So you got the hype around the ETFs. Last time it was what is about companies adopting it, nations adopting it, and so on. And it's just interesting how things are playing out. And they said it was dead again. And we've sat here for the last, God, almost, well, 4 years. We've been, no, actually, sorry, it'd be 3.5, roughly. It'd be, well, all of us have been in Bitcoin. You've been in a lot longer. And we kind of sat down in the dumps, pumping out these pods, talking about how what Bitcoin's doing and kind of, I suppose, helping with mine and Sam Nelvok's knowledge and building that up and getting a true understanding and keeping the faith. And it seems like we're starting to surge again. I know we're all in the black again, which is obviously great. I
Oh,
suppose there'll be
yeah,
some
that's good.
people. Oh, I've been in the black for bloody ages now. I think it's only when we really bottomed out that I wasn't.
Okay.
I was like, oh God, oh God. And then I was just like, you know what? It's probably the investment which I know most about and trust the most. So
Yeah.
principles do not change.
I did think
And if
that when you
they,
first all got in, I did think that you guys were going to be the first people that I knew that just never went into the red. I was like, I don't know how this is fair because Bitcoin doesn't allow this. It just doesn't. And but I
well,
think we're going, at the time, it's like we're going to into hundreds of thousands and then we will dump, but we're going to dump back down above where you bought in at. So you're never going to be in the red. I'm not sure how this works. And
you gotta remember, like,
we
we're
didn't
buying
pump as high and
constantly.
we pumped and we dumped lower. It's like, oh, there you go. Bit
I
everything
was
is right
buying
in the world.
chunks.
Bitcoin got you too.
But you think I was buying chunks all through and I was buying chunks near the top. But
Yeah.
chunks at the top put my DCA quite high. Well, a lot higher than it would have been because of where I bought, but I just kept on buying on principle and when I had cash available. Though I know that when it hit 13, as painful as it was, so Neverlook was throwing it all in. I think he sold a kidney. I think he's giving HJs, BJs, whatever he could do to get that cash into Bitcoin. You know, commitment.
What you got to do, man. But yeah, I was thinking about it, and what I think is, whenever people go in for their first cycle, I think if you come in for the right reason, like you guys did, then you don't get shaken out, you don't lose faith. But if you come in like people like Jim Cramer did, which is just for the gains, it's going to the moon. I think what you get sold on is the whole Ponzi slash scam narrative of Bitcoin, because you come in midway through a bull market. Price keeps going up. You love it. You love it. You believe in all the use cases, but you don't really. You're just loving the gains, and you can't wait to sell your Bitcoin to sell to get some fiat, and then buy the new Lambo, buy a bigger house, whatever. That's really
But
why they're in.
I think it's everyone's journey, isn't it? You kind of
Yeah,
think, I suppose that was mine. I remember we're discussing on this pod about, oh yeah, what you do,
yeah,
you
that
know,
was
Bitcoin moons,
5 years before, though, wasn't it?
and it was always sell it to buy X, you
Yeah.
know, sell it into dollars or pounds or whatever, and that's where you kind of go, okay, that's probably where we've grown quite a bit because we spent so much time as part of this pod looking at Bitcoin. I mean, it's also outside of the pod, myself and Sir Neverlook, reading up on various different aspects, you know, literature around Bitcoin and understanding more. So, you know, we have gone a lot deeper than most people would within our time frame.
Yeah, but just to finish that thought, right? So you've come in, you get all your gains, but then very quickly it goes down, and it goes down almost faster than it went up. So then suddenly you start going, right, well, your real true beliefs come out then, and you're going, well, I'm doing it for the gains. I don't care about El Salvador using it and it solving inflation and da da da. I just want to make more money, and I'm losing money. I've lost all my gains now. Now I'm in the red. And then suddenly all this, oh, it's bad for the environment, it's a Ponzi, it's a scam. You start going, oh my God, is it a scam? Is it a Ponzi? And I think a load of people then just go, I think it is. They sell. And then they don't largely don't look at Bitcoin for a couple of years. And every time they do, the price is largely lower or slightly around where they sold. And they go, yep, yeah, as any Ponzi would do over the next 10 years or something, it's going to trend to zero. And I think that's people what people like Jim Cramer essentially have done. But the point, and at the time, if you just take that very small window of time and you go, it could be a Ponzi or it could be tulips, you could be correct, because it largely just followed that. You've got to ignore the previous 10 years because we're not just in one cycle here. There's like four or five cycles that have happened now. So they're cherry picking their time periods, but it's the time period that they were in Bitcoin for. But then, and quite quick, in a very short period, if you at the end of a bull market and then whilst the bear market starts, it looks like a Ponzi scheme. That's the same graph, straight up and then straight back down. The problem they have is that if you wait long enough, Bitcoin bounces back. And that's exactly what Bitcoin's doing now. And it doesn't bounce back as quickly as it did the first time. Like, to get to 69K, we went from 20K to 60K way too fast. This time it's taken probably 2 years to go from about 15K to 45K. Nice, slow and steady growth. Lots of little dips along the way, but just nice, steady. And now these people that have sold at far less than 45K are coming back to Bitcoin going, well, isn't that meant to be dead now? I sold the last of my coins at 25K and I was really happy because the last I looked, it was 15. And you go, oh yeah, it's 45 now. We're creeping back up to all-time high. Nice and slow and steady. And there's not even a big rush of people coming yet. There's no big, huge 20, 30% candles. We're just pretty much ticking up at 5 to maybe like today with a big day at 7%. But we'll probably go down by 4% tomorrow. It's just nice and slow and steady. We're going up by a couple of percent over the each week, really. And they suddenly go, oh, that isn't what Ponzi schemes do. Ponzi schemes don't come back. Scams don't come back. Once the
How many times did tulips come back?
Yeah,
Whenever I
zero.
see this tulips coming, I'm just like, I think maybe it was a slight little rise a couple of years later for a small amount of time. It didn't come back. What is it, three or four times? It's just a ridiculous argument.
And
But
it's not even small little jumps, is it? It's like literally pumping back to all-time high and then surpasses it by a significant amount.
oh,
And this is
my finger's literally hovering over like the videos on YouTube, like the celebration Bitcoin videos, so I can send them out to people. I'm like, fuck your NFTs, fuck you out, fuck your FUD. This is what I'm in.
yeah, this is
And whilst you've been telling me it's shit and it's dead and I should have gotten earlier, I've been stacking more sats.
exactly. I
So.
think 2024 is going to be one hell of a year for Bitcoiners to be the I told you so lines and
Yeah.
moving out a lot.
I want my all-time high just to start sending the missus memes. Because I
So
think she just
it's
gave up
always
on me early
nice.
on.
It just basically means that every single Bitcoiner that's been in is now up, right? There's no one that's down. It's
Yeah.
nice. It's nice to be in that just new territory. Like, it's a new atmosphere. Every single Bitcoiner that bought Bitcoin at any point, provided you just held it, you're now up on your investment as opposed to fiat. And you go, there we go.
Well, apart from
Everyone's
you bought it.
happy.
Though if you bought at the all-time high and that was your only purchase, you're still down, but don't
Not at the
worry.
moment. But I mean, once you go through all-time high, then you're like, there we
Yeah.
go. We're in a new rarefied atmosphere now. Even the
I
one
think.
person that only ever stacked at 69K, once we hit 70K, we're like, there you go. Even you're in the black now. Congratulations. You did hold, right? You didn't fucking sell it at fucking 15K, did you?
They can start sending the gifts on their WhatsApps about Bitcoin, which I'm l really looking forward to on that group when they're like, they asked me about Bitcoin and then just kind of like disappeared and they're on about NFTs being art and that's going to come back to haunt
Oh, of course.
but anyway, should we get on to on topic this week? Oh, I'm seeing this first story. Bitcoin L1 high fees are back. I missed that. Oh no, actually, I've scrolled down. That's a problem. It
Yeah,
was.
I
I
was
was
like,
looking,
what?
going. I was like, what?
Yeah, that's
It's
last
Kevin
week.
Mc. Yeah, it's Kevin McAllister. So this is our favorite inflation. Doesn't
Nice,
annoy me
nice
quite
and
as
festive,
much.
isn't it?
Yeah, it doesn't annoy me as much. But I read this and I went, I'm going to call a bit of bullshit on this one, surely. So Kevin Mc'Allister's grocery list in Home Alone cost 19.83. Last year, the same grocery list cost $44.40. And I looked at that and thought, Home Alone was what, 1990?
Yeah.
And so over 30 years, it's only doubled, only just over doubled. So I would have thought that would have been higher.
Yeah.
Whereas,
But then bizarrely, it's virtually doubled again in the last year. Yeah.
yeah, that's what's really thrown me on this is because I would have thought if you'd taken out the $44.40 and just had the 72, I would have believed that one because it would have gone 19 to 38 to 72. So going from the halving of the dollar every 15 years, which makes sense.
Yeah.
Whereas this, I'm kind of going, I don't think we've had inflation that high within the last year. We've had a
Oh,
lot in the
yeah.
last 3 years.
Oh, the last year. Yeah. The last 3 years.
Un unless this is from like 2020, the meme or something. Or 2021, it makes sense because, yeah, we've absolutely flown up in the last 3 years. I'm kind of going, doesn't seem to ring true because that 44.40 would be higher.
Yeah, who knows, eh? But yeah, someone's posted in the average salary. 1990, the average salary was 30K. The average salary in 2023, they're saying is 76K. This is in dollars. So they're actually
The
saying there
average
that
salary.
30 and 76. So I'm assuming this is in America. But yeah,
Here
but
we
it's.
go. The average salary in the US, according to Forbes, is 59,000.
Jesus, is the problem with all these fucking inflation numbers? It's like even Bitcoiners don't get the numbers right. Like everyone in this thread is just
Oh,
fucking
they're
wrong.
so different everywhere. But then you've got medians, and then if you take away the unemployed, then it also changes, and you end up with like it all over the place. Because like the UK, I think it's fairly stagnant, isn't it? It's 30 for all, and I think it's 35 or 40 for excluding unemployed and only going full time.
Yeah, it's because it's literally in an era that where every inflation number we have comes from the government. So, and it's heavily manipulated. So whenever someone's trying to do this, but like for the Kevin McAllister shopping budget, basically spends $20 in the film in 1990, and we're basically saying it's around $80 now. It's gone up by 4x. I would roughly guess that's about right. But it shouldn't be that hard, right? You can see the shopping he's got. He puts it all through the checkout and then it falls out on the floor. Although actually, me and my brother actually noticed when the shopping falls out on the floor, that isn't all the shopping. Because he gets home and he's washing his clothes and new shopping powder, and the powder does not fall on the floor. So it's going to be hard.
I watched Home Alone with my kids this Christmas. I didn't notice that.
Oh, well, this is like the 200th time we watched it. Yeah, so you just and I think I also had this thing in my head as well, going, look at the shopping. I want to see how many items he's got. I might even try and do it myself. But each time you see the shopping's different. So you go, they haven't got continuity in the film, even about what you brought. So depending on which scene you take, depends on what the shopping was. But the price is correct. The $19 something, that is what the checkout woman says to him.
Yeah, and $72 I think would be a fair one. I'm throwing doubt on the $44, so I think
Yeah,
that'll
for
be a
that.
lot earlier. What always goes in my head though when I'm watching Home Alone is what the fuck did Kevin McAllister's dad do to have such a large house and take all his family on holiday?
Yeah, because everyone else is sponging off him, aren't they? And this is 1990 as well. He ordered some pizzas. $200 those pizzas were in 1990. That's literally like the pizza boy is asking for a grand now. And he just has the money on him. He's like, oh. A grand. Here you go. Plus tip. Yeah. Another 200 quid tip, and then just walks off. You're like, who is this guy? This guy is freaking minted.
Yeah, I'm on that holiday when I think long haul was a lot more expensive. God knows what he was doing.
He's going from America to Paris. Yeah, that's a and all the parents were in first. All the kids are in coach.
God, yeah, they're in first class as well. Yeah, he's treating his in-laws to fucking first class.
Yeah, it is funny how they put all the adults in first and all the kids are in coach. Yeah, and they just give the oldest kid who's like 16, you're the parent, look after 15 kids that are just basically on a 10-hour flight as well. It's not a short flight. That's multiple meal times, probably an evening sleep. And yeah, fuck the kids. It's so fiat. It's fucking unbelievable, but yeah. Who would
Okay.
do that now? What Bitcoiner would go on a plane and put themselves in first and the kids in freaking coach? Right.
I just,
Kind of crazy, right?
yeah, I think it should be like, yeah, the first class, I think tickets are through the roof. I don't think I could ever just justify paying for first class.
No, the only time I potentially would is on long haul flights like that, because sometimes it becomes a little bit more. But you got to be super wealthy because you. It has to be just money doesn't matter because
Yeah, I think it's not
you're
just like an
paying probably
extra.
three or four times or maybe
Yeah,
even five or six times the price of a ticket just to have a bit more leg room and a free meal and a bit of drink. It's
Exactly. It's not an extra 20% or
no.
10%. It is like five times or so. So it's
Yeah.
just a bit ridiculous.
Yeah, it goes from a grand to 5, 6, 7 grand. That's yeah. But cool. Let's go to Max Kaiser. So that story is a bit of a bust. But this one we've got the ETF. And we've discussed this already, right? So Max Kaiser is basically going, in 40 years of finance, I've never seen so much coordination and cooperation by so many financial institutions working hand in glove with regulators and politicians, as I'm seeing with the coming wave of Bitcoin ETFs. I think we may be in for an unwelcome surprise. And
We've said this.
we've talked
It
about this.
doesn't look good. This is where paper Bitcoin comes in. It's
Yeah.
getting,
It's a bit too convenient, isn't it? Like this entire space, when you look at who he's talking about here, financial institutions, that's basically the banks, they've hated Bitcoin the whole time. Regulators, they've hated Bitcoin. They've called us just terrorist funders. And
one of the leading
then the third group
ETFs.
is politicians. Just about every politician that has any power at the moment is anti-Bitcoin. The only politicians that are pro-Bitcoin are the ones that are trying to get in. But so that's three groups of people that seemingly have really worked well together to make Bitcoin ETFs happen. You go, sus, right?
I think it goes back to like the money. It's like everyone's oh, never become money. It's just like, well, how do you think money's evolved previously? This is what a lot of people don't understand, and I think this is what they've probably looked at and gone, it's inevitable, isn't it? It is inevitable that better money comes along and displaces the current form, especially when you've got fiat in. Yes, traffic cone, what do you want to ask?
I know, I'm just pointing at my sign saying, in retrospect, it was inevitable.
Oh, what are you putting your hand up to
I
ask a
know,
question?
I was agreeing with you.
Yeah, as I was saying, better form of money comes along, and I think they have just looked and gone, it's inevitable, but they thought, how can we take it down or control it? And I think it is a paper Bitcoin, it's got to be, and we've discussed this, which is why it's so important to store your Bitcoin yourself. I'm guilty of having some on Coinbase at the moment, but I need to move it. But majority of my stack is on, like, well, not Ledgers, but Jades. And I think this is what everyone should make sure they're doing. And it's also if you have an elderly relative who wants to buy some money for ETF, maybe encourage them at first, but also start slipping into the head a bit of you want to take custody. The whole point of this is custody. If it's a new form of money, if all these financial institutions are doing it, there must be something about this. Maybe you should just buy a Jade and store it yourself, just a bit of it, though,
Yeah,
just so you can start getting it.
I've actually realized that there is actually a use case even for Bitcoiners for the ETF. It isn't just price appreciation. It's if you have a dumbass pension that you put money in, could I have, for example, I put money in, I can't get it back.
Well, you can. You could
I could put it
set up a
in.
SIP.
Yeah. But it's like, so you basically, yeah, so you've got a certain amount of money that's stuck in the financial system, right? There you go. You've got Bitcoin ETF now, so you at least you're the likelihood of you getting it in the next 20, 30 years slim, but at least you're going to think you're getting it. At least you put your money behind the best asset of the last 500 years. So move your pension into the Bitcoin ETF when it pops up, and then if by some miracle when you retire, it's still there, fantastic. You have a shitload of gains. If not, well, the money was gone anyway. You put it into the pension. It didn't matter what you invested it in. They were probably going to tax you 99% or just steal it completely anyway. But use it for that. So if you've got a pension fund that's stopped there that you no longer pay into, move it into the ETF when it becomes available in the next 3 months or so.
Yeah, so it's going to obviously become available in the US, and then it'll be like dominoes with all the other countries. So, like in the
Yeah.
UK,
Well, the
we're
rumor
probably
is
not going to see it.
they're going to. Because they don't want to play favorites, they're going to basically approve all of the applications all at the same time.
Yeah, so talking, the date which keeps on getting flung around is, I think, the 6th of Jan.
I've heard the 8th or 10th.
Okay, yeah, so it's early Jan, which is getting flung around. So obviously keep your eyes peeled over the next week, see what happens. Obviously we can't guarantee. But if it does happen, I think things are going to go a little bit crazy at first as we get the hype out. And then hopefully we can start throwing the memes around and the Bitcoin songs and start sending to loved ones with I Told You So written in the knee. It'll be the third time, no, actually second time, which Mr. All and we send emojis around.
It's gonna be interesting though, right? Because it's gonna be a bit of a sell the news thing. I always thought this. I did think if we're genuinely this close, like literally within a week of the ETF being approved, we should be at hundreds of thousands of dollars by now. Because once the ETF comes out, it's not like suddenly everyone starts buying it on day one, right?
It's
Once
not been at the it's not been at the top of the news bar, has it? Have you looked in
no.
the mainstream media?
But
It's not the top.
it
It's
wasn't
not on
back
BBC
in
News.
2016 either. Like, because obviously Bitcoin never hits the news until it hits all-time highs. But usually, if an ETF was this close, I remember obviously like the last time I was waiting for an ETF
Yeah,
was
but
back
you're
in
not going to put on BBC
2016.
News. You're not going to have, who is it, Hugh, whatever his, Hugh Davis or whatever his name is, saying, oh, an ETF for Bitcoin's coming along. First question is, what the fuck's an ETF? And the second question is, oh, Bitcoin, I thought that died. What's it doing now? And I just don't think it fits like into BBC. So I think you're probably going to have to sit, watch it fly a bit, but you're going to be, it's going to be taken into people's pensions, first of all. So I think you'll be watching out for that.
Yeah. Have you seen Max's other tweets recently? He's been posting quite a bit about the Saudi Arabia guys. The guys putting on all the boxing. He reckons that they're going to just buy like a couple, like 10, 20, 30 billion worth and just create a god candle. He's like, we're going to jump 100K in a day when they buy. But I don't know how what Max's sources are for this, if he's just shit posting or what, but yeah. It's weird because there are certain individuals that exist in the world, and the Saudi Arabia guys would be in that category where if they just buy some Bitcoin for themselves and buy 1% of their net worth in Bitcoin, they could create 100K day if they genuinely were to do that. So
I
who
just don't
knows?
know if we'd see it because I think over the last few months we found out that oh, what is it? But Bitcoin is oh, what's the correct word for it? It was, you know, proper money for Islam.
Oh right, yeah. Yeah,
So I
it's not
suppose
classed
we
as gambling, yeah.
yeah, so kind of gone. Actually, this is proper money. They really like it as a principle. So maybe it will be, you know, taken in, but ultimately, Saudi Arabia, those kind of people, you know, they've got unlimited money, is what it comes down to, as we've seen with Man City. It comes out plentiful and everyone buys it. They could buy as much Bitcoin if they're actually into it, but who knows?
Yeah, they're the kind of people that if they did come in, they would just be uber whales.
So,
But yeah, I love this next story. This is
moving on, so I saw it, I listened to it, and I sat there really confused because I don't know who the fuck Peter Ansell is.
Oh, which store are you on?
Pedo Bitcoiner.
Oh, Jesus. I haven't Go on, keep going.
Yeah, so I looked at this, and you dropped a link in for Twitter from Triple Elite Media. And it's like Tem owns you. So I was like, first of all, I'm like, who the fuck's Tem? And I realized that the name of the poster is Triple Elite Media. I mean, it's just like this fucking weird video of someone who's been, I think he's been associated with Swan Bitcoin. And it's just him in this video with his face spotted on, then loads of memes everywhere. And I was just like, what the fuck is this about?
Oh no, yeah.
Need to click your fingers, show it, but you need to explain yourself because this is something which I don't even know who he is.
All you had to do is not be able to mute Peter, and it's just love, and like the optimism is flowing this morning.
Is that a dig?
Dude, that's a positive statement. There is no dig. A
No,
dig
no,
would have been
no,
like.
no. Little girls, they make me feel so bad when they're around.
before Bitcoin, I was kind of lost. I didn't, you know, when this kind of thing happened, I didn't really know where to go. There was no warm blanket. There was no cocoon. There was nothing that I owned. I'm going to go back to unconfiscatability again. If you own your own, if you have your own keys, you own the damn thing. It's the only thing I've owned in my entire life. It's the only thing that I can actually trust. It's based on math. It's mine. Nobody can tell me what to do with it. And so when things like that happen in the political world, I can then kind of sit back and go, you know what? I have Bitcoin.
That is, yeah. This is just some hilarious Bitcoin Twitter news. Well, I say hilarious, it's about Peter, but basically what's happened here is Swan have just held an event, right? And there's a guy that's talked on one of their panels. And apparently he's been quite big on Twitter spaces. So he's been in the Swan group talking about Bitcoin in there for a while. And yeah, it's just come out that essentially he didn't even, like, stupid didn't even change his real name. Like, he took like one L out of his name, out of his surname or something. So someone just Googled his name, gone, who is this guy? And it turns out he's got some very serious charges. Apparently he molested some neighbor's kids he was trusted to babysit.
And he's in prison for 10 years.
Yep, he did 10 years in prison. So it's serious.
Well, he was sentenced to 10 years. I don't know if he did 10.
Yeah. Yeah. But he served some serious time. So yeah, people are doing the maths on it. He's got sentenced for 10 years. I think it was around 2009, 2010. Obviously, he's been in Bitcoin for a while now. So everyone's like, Jesus, did he just pop out and go straight into this? Or did he get out? Was it half time? Like, did he only serve five? Like, no one really knows, right? Because he disappeared. The second this came out, he's deleted all his Twitter accounts.
But if he got into 2014, so say that's 5 years from 2009, then, you know, he's going to be getting in at, what, under £100?
Well, that's if you assume, like, Jesus, he comes straight out of prison, gets orange-pilled, and then buys all Bitcoin. It's unlikely that will happen, right?
Yeah, so imagine. he's probably got his Lambo with all his lollipops. but, yeah, so the story is that he was on a Swan,
Yeah, they've got an event called Pacific Bitcoin, yeah. He's just on a panel, yeah, just talking about Bitcoin. But he was never employed by Bitcoin and by Swan. The CEO's come out and gone, look, we'll vet people a bit better. But usually there's a lot of Bitcoiners that use pseudonyms, right? So, you know, I wouldn't, if I went to an event now, I wouldn't use my real name anyway. So it'd be very hard to vet me, for example. And but I guess, who knows, right? Are you honestly going to ask anyone that comes on a panel to do KYC AML? Otherwise, you can't be convinced. They've given you a real identity. So then when you search the internet for that identity, you know, I could give a fake name. So, yeah, I mean, it's a bit of a tricky one. And I think if anything, you know, my takeaway really is from it that Bitcoin is for everyone, right? And we do let people talk, and provided you talk a good, have good opinions, then you're going to get a voice. But then what should happen has happened, really, in any small kind of citadel type environment. You are going to get people that appear from the outside and seem like good people and try and merge into your community. But then someone from a neighboring town or village will come and talk to you. They'll see a guy sitting in one of your, you know, cafes or whatever. And you go, you do know that guy's a pedo, don't you? And you go, is he? Prove it then. And if they pull out, like, here it is, and they prove it, you go, fuck that guy then. And you go over and you kick him out. And that's what's happened here. You know, the community kicks him out. He left in shame. He'll never to show his face in Bitcoin again. He's a disgusting piece of shit. He seems to have molested at least two kids, served significant time for that. Usually I am once you serve your time, that's it. But you go, no, you don't serve your time and that's it when it's pedo stuff. Like, no. Yeah. You're done for life when you mess around.
It's the repercussions on these young girls, you know, 10 years on, yeah. What they're young adults, and it's fucked them up for life, hasn't it? He'll
Yeah,
probably be
obviously,
getting
none of us know the
therapy.
details of exactly what he did, but I'm like, it sounds like it's serious enough to do 10 years. Then I never want to be associated with you or be in the same room with you. It's you're done. So that's what's happened here. So, and I think people don't like Swan. So they've taken it's a big opportunity to start shitting on Swan. Go, are they employee pedos? Maybe they're all pedos. And you go, come on. I don't really get where the Swan hate comes from, really, other than the fact that there's a lot of them on Twitter and some of them have got a couple of bad takes here and there. But it doesn't make Swan a bad company. They seem to just be trying to onboard Bitcoiners. They're a Bitcoin-only company. And yeah, okay, fine. They put a pedo on their stage once, but it's been identified. It's not like they're defending him and going, he's going to continue to speak for us now. We don't care. He's done his time, so we're going to let him speak on Bitcoin at a Swan event. The second they found out, they've gone, oh my God. Obviously, he's never speaking again, and so it's like, well, they like what more do you want them to do, really? Like, because it's like I said, the only way to really guarantee that no one's got a criminal record when they speak at a Bitcoin event is to do KYC AML and probably also a criminal record check. And you go, isn't that what the banks do? Isn't that the system we're leaving? So I think we almost have to accept that occasionally you're going to get these bad characters appear in Bitcoin. Potentially build some influence and either look to scam or either look to hide previous crimes. But hopefully, the truth will come out eventually. And then we can decide as a community, do you want to engage with this person or not? And in this instance, this guy's made the decision for us. He knew that no one would accept him and he'd be hounded out of every Bitcoin event ever. So he's deleted all his social media, he's disappeared, and we'll probably never hear him again. So, job done, really. Better than a KYC and AML check in my eyes. Just let him speak once. Someone else Googles his name for us. Boom, gone. There you go. Done.
Fair enough. I don't think I can really add much more to that. Do you want to move on to Hamas
Yeah,
and this
this is the
ridiculous
story I thought we
story?
were moving on to. That one's a bit of like a freaking weird one, but this
Oh, man.
one's just a good old dunk on the U.S.
So, what's interesting about this is you read it, and if you read it, like, I suppose, not knowing the news for the last couple of years, you'd be like, bullshit. Bullshit. So, Asher Hopper, I don't know who the hell he is, but he's got this tweet, which is Joe Biden gave the Taliban $86 billion worth of Black Hawk helicopters and machine guns. So you kind of go, oh, should we fact check that? Well, we know it's true because it's all over fucking mainstream media. You know, they left tanks, they left bases, they left guns, they left rockets, they left everything. And there are infographics all over the internet for this. So we know it's true. I don't know if it's quite 86 billion, but it was billions, you know, absolute billions
Yeah,
worth.
because they left in 24 hours, didn't they? After a 20-year war in Afghanistan, they
Yeah,
left in 24 hours and they didn't have enough time.
to take Afghanistan from the Taliban,
Yeah, and
and
they
they
ended up
spent
leaving
20
the
years.
Taliban with more
Yeah,
power and
they
influence,
gave.
plus a US army worth of guns, weapons, and helicopters.
Yeah, and the next one, Iran. So this is from CNN as a news clip. So once again, it's proven they've given Iran 6 billion. I'm not entirely sure why they gave Iran
And
six billion.
that was only 3 months ago.
What was the reason for the 6 million to Iran?
Well, I don't know the official reason, but the unofficial reason is so Iran could give a load of it to Israel to bomb the shit out of Gaza and the Palestinians. That's where the money went. But who knows? Because the last I heard from a politician in America talking about Iran, they were literally saying they should blow the whole country up. But then 3 months ago. Yeah, they're donating 6 billion to it. I think that their usual reason is just it's for aid. Like it's
Yeah, but they hate Iran.
because I remember, yeah, but there it's America, right? And they always play both sides. Because I
Oh yeah,
remember we
so it's
covered the story.
the release of five Americans. It's like they don't pay fucking kidnap ransoms. They're not going to pay 1.2 billion per person.
I know. It's why it's always funny. Like, you just follow the money, don't you? And you go, oh, how did this massive war in Palestine and Israel happen? And you go, oh, when did it start? Oh, around October. Where did all these guns and weapons come from just before there? Oh, look, here's a 6 billion coming from America straight
Oh,
into Iran. And they
the
went,
bit.
but this is only for aid. Do not spend any
Well,
of this on guns.
it
And they
was for
went,
the release of
thank you,
five
God.
Americans, 1.2 billion per American.
What do you mean? What's that?
So the official line is America released $6 billion in sanctioned money to Iran for the release of five Americans. So
Oh, right. Yeah.
1.2 billion per person. It's
It's so
just it
stupid and
just
weird,
doesn't
right?
happen. You know, even
And as if
if
you'd
it's
ever put
Biden.
that public, because that just means kidnapping Americans is the most profitable activity you can do. You literally get paid $1 billion per one. And but yeah, the
But I
whole reason
thought.
we're talking about this anyway, isn't it? So we 86 billion went to the Taliban, 6 billion went to Iran, but what's Bitcoin done?
So Hamas had $873,000 in Tether, and thus Big Lizzie is planning to ban crypto because of it.
And don't forget as
And it's
well,
just.
because Tether is a stable coin, centralized piece of shit, they actually froze them anyway. Actually, no, they were on an exchange. So for whatever reason, Hamas, we're supposed to believe, right, that Hamas have got a freaking, I think it was Binance, had a Binance account. And they, let's just round up to $1 million, right? Or I mean, let's say that it's 1 million. Because like they, and it's 1 million with an M. And everything else is billion. And 1 billion, 1 billion is 1 million million. So we're literally talking
Oh
about.
no, the American definition's 1,000 million.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
Is it?
It's a dumb. How many million in a billion? 1,000, yeah. So you're right, the proper definition should be a million
Oh.
million. But
Oh, it's just next to the zero.
yeah, in American land it's 1,000.
Yeah, so you've basically got, so yeah, so they're talking about, yeah, so there's 1,000 million and 1 billion then, and then we're talking about 86,000 million and 6,000 million, and we're talking about 1 million here that supposedly went to Hamas that they held on an exchange, and by the way, they didn't even get them because they froze it, and for some
So,
reason,
if
Elizabeth
you're a
Warren was
tech,
saying Bitcoin is funding
no.
terrorism in the
Let's just go
world.
back on that two things. So, you're Hamas, you're a terrorist group. You want some stable coins so you can trade around the world to make sure you get supplies. So, do you leave that money on an exchange or do you take out and put it on some hardware wallets because you need to trade?
And because you're also a terrorist organization. So
Yeah,
maybe
so.
the whole reason you're using Tether is because you know if you have a bank account, you're going to get it frozen. So.
It so sounds pretty like BS. It's like that one where they said that some hackers demanded Bitcoin and ransom, but they left the keys to the wallet on the server which they were hacking for
Yeah.
the power grid. And it's
They
just
just
like,
stole the Bitcoin back.
do you think everyone is born yesterday? And it was also, oh yeah, it was like five Bitcoin or something like that. No, sorry, realistic figure. It's something like 6 million or something in Bitcoin. It's like if they're taking down the whole of the West power grid. It would be billions, not something like 6 million. So it's another bullshit thing. It's like the Taliban, if they were so bad and such terrorists, they wouldn't be having under $1 million in Tether. It would be tens or hundreds. You know, it just, the whole story stinks, doesn't it?
Yeah, and it's just silly because even as a fake story, it doesn't really work. Like at least, like basically $1 million of Bitcoin for Hamas. Like, come on, like it's just at least make it a bit more because like literally the missiles and stuff they're firing constantly at each other. Like they're like 10, 20, 30K a pop. So like $1 million doesn't go very far when that's your freaking that's going to last you about 15 minutes. You ever been paintballing? You know how much those freaking bullets cost? Jesus. And imagine firing wheel bullets. You need millions and millions and millions. So like, what? So if you're gonna try and say Hamas is being funded by a stable coin or by Bitcoin, at least make it like 10, 20 million that you've frozen. Like this, because we clearly this is likely just a fake account that someone just sent some money to, said it was Hamas, and then just has frozen it and gone, haha, got you. Just send 20 million to it instead.
You're
Don't
sounding a
don't.
bit like a con you're sounding like a bit like a conspiracy theorist there.
Yeah, the funny thing is, like, what even like, let's just go along and assume that I'm completely wrong on that. This is a Hamas thing. They did have a, they are using Tether, and they did use an exchange. Still, the argument is still, well, $1 million does not go very far when you're fighting a an endless war with Israel. So what are they funding the rest of their terrorism with? It has to be fiat, right? So even if they are using some of it from the crypto world, okay, we're responsible for like 0.1% of it. What's the other 99% of the funding that they are getting? It's in fiat and probably in US dollars. Even though they're freaking all halfway across the globe in Israel, they're probably using US dollars to buy guns, weapons, supplies. So that completely gets missed from the story as well. Anyway, if this was billions, if this was, 8 billion ended up in Hamas's hand and it was in Tether stablecoin, I'd agree. That's a story right there. Because that's comparable now to what the US have directly done with the Taliban and Iran. But it's not. It's less than $1 million. This is literally just like taking a pea shooter. Literally that 6 billion went to Israel. So the fact that $1 million worth of Tether and ended up in Hamas's hand, it's like, okay, they got a pea shooter, you've got an army of tanks. I don't think the fact that some illegal money got to them to buy a pea shooter was going to change the game. I think they still lose badly. So I don't think it's much of a threat to you. And you froze it anyway. Like, they didn't even get it. They couldn't even spend it. You froze it.
Yeah. Doesn't
Hello.
stop Biz, doesn't stop Biz li Big Lizzie though.
Doesn't.
Another day, another pile of shit by Big Lizzie doing a job, making sure Bitcoin doesn't get in. But moving on to one which I don't think I really want to spend much time on because it's ordinals. Ordinals just irritate the shit out of me. And all the
Yeah.
talk about ordinals irritates the shit out of me. So am I right? So this one here is the first DDoS of ordinals.com. Is that where all the images are stored?
I don't even know. The only reason this is in here, right? So ordinals.com has got DDoS attack. So the reason this is funny is because ordinals is essentially doing what is the equivalent of a DDoS attack on Bitcoin. And they're going, no, it's not a spam attack, it's not a DDoS attack on Bitcoin. So the reason why your fees are going up, like, we're just using the chain, right? We're just using the chain for what it's designed for. So you're spamming the shit out of it, sending stupid images or the links to images, supposedly to new people for like tens of thousands of dollars each. We know what you're doing. You're saying it to each other because you're all rich from various crypto scams. So you're spending millions and millions on fees, sending links to images to yourselves, hoping that you can pump a market and create fake liquidity enough to sucker in some dumb money that will randomly buy a couple of 50K images off you. And then realize there's no one else buying them. Like, all these other purchases of all these other images are fake, right? So essentially, by doing all that, they have been spamming the Bitcoin blockchain. And we've been talking to these guys for fucking ever. And they're like, no, we're not spamming. It's legitimate use. Bitcoin is free. And it's like, all right. So someone's just gone, boom, DDoS attacked their website. And now the whole argument back is, it's just valid web traffic, bruh. We're just visiting your website a lot, bruh. Oh, has it gone down? Can no one now use it? Ah, sucks. Sucks that, doesn't it? Isn't that unfortunate? It's just a little bit boom, like, plus play them at their own game, the stupid idiots. You freaking DDoS attack the Bitcoin blockchain, would DDoS attack your website? How'd you like that? And they're all complaining, going, oh, how petty are this, are the Bitcoin maxis DDoSing our website? You go, if you heard yourself, you've been DDoSing attacking the Bitcoin blockchain for the last couple of months.
I see the top poster on mine at least is Luke Dashier.
There you go. Yeah.
And I was just like, is this a big coincidence, Luke?
I know. You can see this in his sleep. Yeah. How dare you call it a DDoS? Pretty sure everyone involved is paying their internet bills. Yep. There you go. We all pay our internet bills. We're all allowed to access the internet. And if I want to send 1 million requests a second to your website to load the page, I fucking well am allowed to.
Yeah, and there'll be a bunch of them as well. It won't just be one
Oh yeah.
person.
Like, if there's like anonymous that you don't want to piss off. I mean, there's another group of people, like core Bitcoin developers. You don't want to piss these guys off. Like, these guys could take your website down and turn it into freaking
I think there's I
Quick
think there's a
fix in
debate.
seconds.
Yeah, there's a debate stuff which is going on with Luke, which not everyone agrees with his points of view, but I think there's fundamentals which no one really wants ordinals, whereas he just fucking hates it. Absolutely, doesn't he?
Yeah. Do you know, actually, over Christmas, I actually watched Unconfiscatable, or a couple of hours of it anyway. It's the last conference I went to back in 2020. And so the conference happened again in December. So I've been catching up on it, and Luke and his CEO of Ocean were on a panel talking about ordinals. Two people pro ordinals, two people not. And actually, Luke didn't talk that much. He's very chatty on Twitter. He's not a very chatty in person. He's quite a quiet guy.
Was a keyboard warrior.
He's just an introvert, right? He's not an extrovert. And I think when a question gets asked, he likes to just distill and think of his answer. So he'll take a couple of minutes to answer a question, as opposed to someone else will just start talking. And then what I realized is that, and it's kind of what I suspected, is that Luke being the front of a company is not a good idea. You need to put him behind
He's
someone
a
that's,
CTO, isn't he?
yeah. And a CTO that should freaking not have a social media account, unfortunately, or at least like have him like not talk engaging, like let him do talk about the business, but like don't let him talk about controversies. Because his CEO was sat next to him and he answered the question basically about what they've been doing. And he answered it so succinctly, so clearly. It's because the main controversy, right, was when they were like basically banning ordinals from coming in. They've just gone, that's always been our plan. The way that we're going to cut the op return, amount of code that's allowed to be an op return, we knew it was going to not allow ordinals to come in. And, but yeah, then Samurai came out and went, oh, they're censoring our transactions. Ocean don't allow CoinJoin now. They're disgusting. They're attacking us. And their CEO just went, look, we didn't realize they were doing CoinJoin like that. There's no reason to do CoinJoin like that. We don't even know why they're doing CoinJoin in the way they are doing, where they have such a large op return text. So we're going to have a call with them later, talk to them about how to do CoinJoin better, and get them to fix it so they're not spamming the Bitcoin blockchain as much as they are, and they can do CoinJoin more effectively, because every other CoinJoin company wasn't affected. They got caught in the crossfire because they're doing it a bit inefficiently. So we'll talk to them, help them do it more efficiently, and we'll just move on. I don't know why there's been all this controversy about censoring CoinJoin. Wasn't our intention. We love CoinJoin. We want more privacy in Bitcoin. And you go, holy shit.
Okay.
Like, you need your CEO talking more. That's why he's the CEO and he's the technical guy. You need the CEO fucking talking more, because that would have just quelled all of this. But Luke just fucking starts throwing petrol on the fire. It's just, I don't think he even means to. He just loves to be fucking. Even when someone would, even like, say he was on this call now and I just said that, which is virtually, I probably bastardized it slightly, but largely is what his CEO said. If I asked him, do you agree with that? You go, no. Like, Luke, just say yeah. He's like, no, you got a bit wrong. He's so pedantic, so exact, which a lot of developers are, but he's just not good for PR, because you just need nice clarity and go, look, in principle, are you doing something good for Bitcoin or bad? Because if you're censoring transactions that are CoinJoin ones, that is bad. And fundamentally, the CEO just went, we had no intention of doing that, but yes, we did. So we have now talked to them and published it and given technical advice now. If anyone else wants to do CoinJoin, do it like this, and you'll bypass this. You go, Jesus Christ. So it was a storm in a teacup, but yeah, but Unconfiscatable is available on YouTube. Tone Vases podcasts. Channel. So there's hours and
So,
hours, about 8 hours of content from each day on YouTube.
oh
It's
geez.
live streamed. It's and the panels are amazing. They really are amazing.
So next one is a questionnaire which we've all been waiting to appear, which is basically just say that you trade at your own risk. It's what I take from this. So you've posted a screenshot from, where was it? Kraken, the one which you've done. So this is, they ask for an assessment where you're understanding crypto, whether you're liable for your losses, what the nature of it is, blah, blah, blah. So you can actually trade on it. So basically prove you're not an idiot. I think it's going to be a long road to the kind of clamp down, to be perfectly honest, is how I see this. It's going to be further regulation, further regulation, further regulation till it strangles, which is a worrying thing because this is the first step. I need to move my Bitcoin. I was about to say crypto, but I don't have crypto apart from that. But I need to move a Bitcoin off Coinbase as soon as possible just to make sure that it is off.
Yeah, well, it's weird because we only discussed this, I reckon it was like 3 or 4 months ago, where some regulation came out in the UK, and it was we're reading through it going, what does this actually mean? Because it looked very draconian, going, holy shit, are they going to stop people investing their money? But really, what it came down to was, no, you have to educate the people coming in, and they had like these 25 questions that you have to, or 25 points that have gone, you need to cover these points. By going, do the people investing understand all these kind of points? So I've seen this now. I've done it on Revolut, Kraken, and I also did it on Gemini. And yeah, I'd imagine Coinbase. Oh yeah, I literally tweeted literally that. But then Coinbase, I can't see on Coinbase because they closed my account. So I don't know. But this is clearly only for UK people, and obviously all these exchanges have rolled this out. Because for the beginning of the new year, I think actually they allowed you until like 3 weeks or 2 weeks into January that if you hadn't completed this questionnaire, you're going to be blocked from being able to trade
Okay, so I might as well.
basically buy Bitcoin.
So I'll try and tran I'll transfer all my Bitcoin first, and then I'll do the
Have
questionnaire
you not
just in
had the
case.
questionnaires pop up on yours?
I haven't been on it this year so far.
Oh, right. Not even in Revolut.
I had somebody ask me something, but I postponed it at the end of last year. I just went, I can't be bothered dealing with this right now, so I just need to transfer it, and then I'll worry about the questionnaires later once I've got my sats out.
Yeah, it's obviously nice and easy. Like the questions are,
Yeah,
but they're pretty dummy. They're pretty noddy.
I just want to make sure I've transferred all my stuff out first.
Yeah,
So
it's just
I need to
interesting, right?
be, yeah, I
Because
need to be down to zero first.
oh yeah, you definitely get it off exchanges. But just
Yeah.
imagine if you sit down at the blackjack table, and before you're allowed to put a bet on, they go, "Excuse me, sir, we have to get you to pass these 10 questions first." And they just give you a little questionnaire.
I
You
remember
fill it.
going
And
to
then what's the
a
first? Obviously, they're plying you a drink, right? It's 3 a.m. You're freaking 10 whiskeys in. And all you want to do is bet you like $20 on this blackjack hand. And they're like, sir, we need to make sure you're responsibly gambling. So answer these 10 questions. You can't even fucking read. You're just like going, ah. You give it back. You clearly got a number of the questions wrong, and they go, sorry, sir, we're going to refuse your bet. Never going to happen. If
Yeah, I
anything,
remember
when I
going.
sit down at a blackjack table that pissed, they go, sir, would you like a drink? And they
I
happily
remember
accept the
going to a
bet.
casino with you and another. We went out in the city, and it was the end of the night. It must have been like 2 or 3. We went to a casino. I remember walking. The bouncer looked at me, let me in. I was smashed, and then when I played what's it called? Craps table. I was absolutely smashed playing that. I think I was holding onto the table one hand, and I was still betting money.
Craps is a very hard game to play pissed as well, that one. That's freaking, there's a lot going on.
That
I
was
can just
probably my first.
about add up to 21. Although even I've been in casinos in Vegas. I've nearly hit on 20. I tried to hit on 21 once. It's just you fucking shouldn't be it's just fucking nuts. You can't count to 21 because I'm hammered. I'm so drunk. And like literally the dealers saved me. It's like, hit. He's like, sir, you got 21. I'm like, no, I have. Like, I do not want to hit this hand.
Sir, you got 21. Hit me, sir.
Yeah.
21, sir. You can't split. Hit me,
Yeah,
sir.
because I honestly think like they could have easily just hit the hand, said bust, and taken my cards, and I wouldn't have known anything. I didn't even know what I was looking for.
Yeah, but I think if you actually got like that, they probably do have some like responsibility. But yeah, the point stands that they're trying to put this nonsense in when what they do with gambling is immoral, isn't it?
Yeah, they literally, they're allowed to feed you with alcohol, free alcohol. provided you're putting bets on.
And
Whereas,
you kind of think about all the
and even
adverts
this,
as
like,
well.
what about just on normal shares and stuff? Buying GameStop shares and freaking yellowing in, doing 10x freaking leverage on whatever, right? Freaking Forex trading and all this stuff, all the scams that people get involved in.
Robin Hoods, you sign up and you what is it, you get to do one of those things where you press a button, it comes up with what shares you get a free match for free when you first join.
Oh my, yeah, literally, like, it's freaking casino, isn't it? Yeah. And yeah, but because it's shares, oh no, they're responsible. They've all gone through the IPO process, so they're all legitimate companies. These legitimate companies can still go bust tomorrow and lose all of your money, but you have to go through a dumbass questionnaire. The second you're buying Bitcoin, oh, now you have to go through a questionnaire. Like we said last time, they're just putting a little extra, because the bit of friction involved, because and that little bit of friction, it will stop some people buying. If anything, it'll probably be good for them, because if they're e that easily put off buying Bitcoin that this questionnaire makes it too hard and they cancel out of the app and just decide
They'll
not
buy
to
it through the
buy.
ETF. The ETF will be seamless.
Yeah, well, I'd imagine they won't be able to get around this. They will have to answer these questions on the ETF as well, unless there's some weird rules around it. But which, to be fair, maybe there is, because it's like, oh, you're not really buying crypto, you're buying the BlackRock ETF, which is still Bitcoin, but somehow safer. Because if Bitcoin goes to zero, then technically your ETF goes to zero. So it should be the same restrictions should comply. But
Morgan Stanley, BlackRock gets profit off you. So that makes it all right.
yeah, they get to take 1-2% a year just for that is so freaking criminal, isn't it? Literally, this.
Yeah, well,
Even if
I'm
the ETF
hoping.
isn't a scam, like taking 1-2% of Bitcoin gains
It's
for
getting the
everyone's
gains.
retirement fund is going to make someone stupidly rich, right? Even if they don't just scam and take the full lot,
But
1 or 2% is enough.
it is, as Max says, it's a gateway to pay for Bitcoin, but it's also, I'm thinking about the upsides, which is just getting the boomers in, getting people money in, and then hopefully the education can start from there. When we go, oh, I've got Bitcoin, this is exciting. We do a bit of reading about it. Maybe they read the Bitcoin Standard and we go on the journey then.
Yeah.
But going on to something which is also what I think is a bit of a Trojan horse is Argentina. It's become another subject which I'm hating to see across Twitter, because you get the two opposing groups. You get like the people who are like, oh, this is terrible that he wants to abolish the central bank. He's going to make them worse. It's like, how the fuck can you make Argentina worse than an average of 1,000% inflation over the last 50 years? It's like the most fucking stupid comment which I've ever written. But when you get people going, oh, but he's doing this and this, it's just like, I just don't trust him. He's a wefer, isn't he? He
Yeah.
is a Trojan horse. Like, I just, but everything which he's doing, it kind of makes sense. You kind of go, he's cutting the government, because the fundamental problem with westernized countries is we have massive governments, so they can siphon money out taxes and also do inflation, which is why we end up with the inflation, because we can't afford to keep the governments going, because they've got so many services and they're also siphoning so much money out, which is what they're doing in Argentina. And so Argentina is trying to scale everything back, and part of it is he's trying to bring in the US dollar, and I think giving alternatives for his people to actually save. And so everything which he's doing looks right, but he just, everyone, I think most people are smelling a rat with him.
Yeah, but on this individual decision, Javier Milei, the new president of Argentina, but basically he's made every single currency in the world legal tender in Argentina, which in theory, provided there is no manipulation or kind of just corruption in the background, where there are hidden incentives to use one currency over another, then this is exactly all Bitcoiners want. We don't want Bitcoin to be forced as legal tender and to force people to use it and outlaw fiat. If anything, all we want is just to go allow Bitcoin to be money everywhere, and we'll win by being better money. The people that use the fiat in each country will slowly but surely see that they have to invest their money. They get inflated away with inflation, Whereas the people
But
that
what
just
he...
happen to hold their money in Bitcoin will continue to, the money they earn this year is just more worth more and more each year. Whereas when you hold it in fiat, it's worth less and less. So eventually all roads lead to
But
Bitcoin.
we'll put a big button here for Argentina. He has asked them, if you declare that you have crypto, then you get taxed less. And that is just like, ooh, shit, here we go. Here's gold confiscation version two.
Yeah, that was one of his other announcements that people didn't like, yeah, which was, yeah, declare how much crypto you have now and you can get taxed less, whereas if you don't, then when you do sell it later on, we'll tax you more. So that does sound like he's just surveilling and finding who are the people I potentially need to go after. Because who are the big Bitcoin holders in my country, basically? And it's asking you just to reveal yourself to the government and go, oh yeah, I'm a big Bitcoin whale over here. Can I have 5% over the next couple of decades when you know, maybe I sell a little bit to buy houses and stuff? Can I get taxed less when I do that? Is it for that, or does he want to put a black mark next to your name and go, here's someone to look after? This is who the WEF has been talking to me about. These are the guys I need to arrest when the time comes. Who knows? But this story is about having basically all currencies be made legal, which, but yeah, but the fact that Bitcoin is still taxed and still isn't really seen as legal tender and is a taxable event every time you sell it, unfortunately, it doesn't actually mean it's a level playing ground. So it's not the free market. Because if you buy stuff with Bitcoin in Argentina, that's a taxable event. Capital gains are due on that. Whereas if you use dollars or Argentinian pesos or whatever they use, then there is no taxable event that's happened. It's just fiat. It's just currency. So even if you bought your dollars and then technically those dollars are worth double what the Argentinian money was worth, it's not like you've made double every time you spend it. It's just no. You just made a good choice on your money. You get to buy double what that guy can buy because he invested in the wrong asset. You got the right one. And it should be the same with Bitcoin. I mean, Bitcoin should be sat there going, oh, yeah, I have 10 times the money than the next guy because I held in the best form of money. But then when you go to buy, oh, we want 20% of the gains in between there, please. And you go, what, why? Why? You didn't do it to the dollar against that currency. Why are you doing it against Bitcoin against that currency? And it's because fundamentally at the moment, governments and politicians don't see Bitcoin as money. They see it as an asset that can have losses and gains on it. And Bitcoiners don't see it as that. Bitcoin's just money. And of course, it's going to have huge gains against fiat. Fiat's trending to zero. It's 99% down since it launched, 80 years ago. So how can you not make gains on anything that is better than fiat? That's not very difficult. But so yeah, actually, yeah. Because Samson Mao is the one that posted this. And there's a few people super positive about it, going, oh yeah, let the free market decide. But yeah, you reminded me about that tax story. Goes, yeah, Bitcoin isn't legal as money in Argentina because of this. It's still a taxable event, which still means it's in. If you're going to use it legally like this, it's still an inferior money to like the dollar, really, because it's just clunky. You have to freaking record every transaction and make sure you pay it on your tax return at the end of the year. That's a pain in the ass. So a lot of people are going to go, screw that. I use dollars. So. We've got to get rid of this tax burden when you sell Bitcoin. That's if Milei did that, I'd start believing him. If they actually said, okay, fine, zero taxes on Bitcoin when you're just buying and selling things. Yeah. I almost wouldn't mind if he goes, if you're doing this as a job, if you're a trader and you're making gains in Bitcoin, like that's taxable event because that's your job. I go, kind of okay, because that's an income tax. Obviously, I hate all taxes, but at least that tax is very much established and whatever. But you should just make Bitcoin should be comparable to the US dollar for taxes, which i.e. there are none. So until he does that, he's still a WEF Trojan horse.
Suppose I'm trying to think of a lead into the next story about failing, but looking at the next story, got a big one about Mt. Gox, or a potential big one about Mt. Gox. So this is quite a big one because I think this is the final big story about Mt. Gox that they've started to receive payouts. So this is what, 10 years after?
Yeah, 2013 it all went under, so 10, 11 years.
Now, my big question, which I couldn't find in all the comments, is they're paying out to people who had Bitcoin on the exchange. What rate are they paying it? Because they're paying it in dollars, aren't they? Are they paying it at 2013 rates or 2023 rates?
Apparently, it's 2013 rates.
Okay, now.
So, whoever held it for those 11 years gets to hold the difference. So, yeah, your account back in 2013, essentially, they denominated it in dollars. So they didn't denominate it in, because there's obviously lots of coins, lots of shit coins, and all that stuff. So they didn't. So it's, in certain cases, say you had
But
there'd be the
didn't
odd
they
person
seize
that.
the Bitcoin? They seized the Bitcoin at the time, didn't they?
Yeah, what was left? Like obviously a lot of it was stolen. So because that's why the exchange went under. But there'd be the odd person. Bizarrely, it's probably the one time where shitcoining maybe helped you. Because let's just assume that in 2013 you had like 100 grand of some random shitcoin that now is defunct. They would have like valued your account then at $100,000. And now today, 11 years later, those shit coins are worth zero. They still owe you the 100 grand. They're not paying you back 100%. I think they're paying you back some like 7 to 10% of the value of the account. That's roughly how much collateral has been recovered. So there's less than 10%. But you'll basically be getting, say, 7 grand back from an account that was worth 100. But if you'd have just held those coins, it'd have gone to zero anyway. Where it's really going to sting is if you had 100 grand of Bitcoin back in 2013. You'd now probably be in the tens of millions, and instead you're going to get 7 grand. But the problem is, what they are doing is they have a shit ton of Bitcoin that is sat there, and we can see they are selling that Bitcoin to then sell to basically give the people the dollars. So there's going to be a huge amount of Bitcoin left, because obviously there's they're only paying back 7 to 10% of what people had. Because I'm pretty sure that the gains, they're just keeping the gains. But the good thing also is that obviously for a long time this has been hanging over Bitcoin, just specifically the price, to go that Mt. Gox and the Japanese authorities that essentially hold these coins. I've forgotten how many they hold now, but it was like 60 to 100,000 Bitcoin. It's a lot. A lot of Bitcoin is held in this fund. And so when they start to sell it, could seriously impact price. So it looks like they've started selling. This is on Boxing Day. The story broke. Well, the price is still pumping. And
Yeah, I think
I think
it's.
to a large degree, it just feeds in perfectly to the next story, which is, well, if they're dumping tens of thousands of Bitcoin right now, who the fuck is buying it? It's because the price keeps going up. Where we are, freaking, here's Michael Saylor doing his freaking Boxing Day DCA. And he goes and buys another 14,620 Bitcoin. You go, yeah, for 615 million. Here we are. Here's he's buying it. Hey,
It's
what say
that's
this?
a big chunk. He's been buying smaller chunks lately, hasn't he?
Yeah, well, I think his last DCA was about that size. It was big. But yeah, but during the majority of the bear market, he was not buying hundreds of millions. He was buying like 20, 30 million, which for him is small. Now he's jumped up to $500 million worth buys. And you go, okay, that's.
He's confident now. Now he's repaid that debt.
Yeah, I think that is part of it. And I think he's like, it just proves that even Saylor is a bit like drawn in by the emotions of where the market is as well. Because if he believed in Bitcoin as much as he seemingly does here, he should be buying $500 million worth of Bitcoin a year ago, 2 years ago, when the price was really down.
I don't think he could get the backing then because he was under. You see,
Yeah.
he had to repay that loan. So I
But he was
think,
buying piddly amounts, right? It was I know
yeah,
it was
he was
that
doing.
loan, but
But I think he was doing as much as he could without sinking the company. Whereas now it's back to buying loads. And then it's also, I think, if you could get a view of what he's actually bought as a person into his personal stack, you'd probably see his conviction then, and I
yeah.
expect that to be maxed out. I think he'd be applying for credit cards from literally Macy's and whoever else he could just to get more Bitcoin.
Yeah. Everyone thinks he's trying to get the 210,000 Bitcoin. So he's got 1% of the supply. He's on 189,000 at the moment.
Well,
So he
this is a potential year when it becomes impossible for him to actually complete that.
Exactly. So he's got 21,000 Bitcoin to get, and then he
That's
gets.
a funny one. To get
Yeah.
200, to get 1%, he's got to get 0.1%.
Yeah. He's
Race against time.
yeah. And he's like, once this ETF launches, the whole hope of getting 1% is gone. But it's kind of nuts. But he's massively up now, yeah, because it's he's what is it? He's brought it. Oh no.
31,000. His average price for his stack for MicroStrategy is 31,000.
Oh yeah, there it is, yeah. 31K.
What's it in dollars?
What, 31K? Yeah, so he's at 31K, so and we're at 44K or 45K now. So he's up
About
50%.
oh jeez, yeah, cause I struggle with the dollars because I always just look at it in pounds. I know I should probably actually look for it in the world markets.
But yeah, he's a couple of billy in the black. He's one of the people that we're talking about really, because I think he's similar really. He came in the last bull market, brought halfway up, which is why his average buy price is 31K, but fair play to him.
His
Came in, he's one of the last people.
conviction hasn't wavered.
No. But it's interesting how, as the price goes up, the buys get bigger, and you just go, common sense would say, and
But
obviously life is hard, but as the price goes down, your buys should get bigger, and then as the price goes up, your buys should get smaller. But
I think that's a personal one. Like personally, like I said, if you could see his money, I think you'd probably see more of a pattern on that. But for a business, they have to raise collateral in order to buy it. So they've got a loan, they've got to convince other board members, etc., to buy.
have you seen what he's been doing though? Like, I don't know what he did on this one, but on the last one where he bought half a billy, he basically inflated his shares. He inflated his shares by like 7% or something. Just bought a load of Bitcoin with it and just diluted all shareholders. And this went, go fuck yourself, because Bitcoin's essentially pumped you 30, 40% in the last 6 months. So I'm taking 7% of it back to buy another half a billion worth of Bitcoin. And no one complained. Everyone's just like, oh, we've got more Bitcoin. Yeah, you got 7% less shares. All right, that sucks. But my shares are up 40%. Yeah, exactly. So you're still happy. Let's go. And now your shares are going to go up even faster because we've got more Bitcoin.
They're
So
fairly flat, aren't they, MicroStrategy? No, actually, they had a big dip. Oh, this is quite funny. If you look at them, they've been floated since 2021, March, and they were quite high near $8, and then they went right down when the price of Bitcoin went down. And now we've started getting the upward tick. So we're starting to go back to what we're on 660 now. So
They're flying now.
yeah, it's pretty much they're too attached to the Bitcoin price, but I think now we're starting to see it flying with the ETF. We may see MicroStrategy share price going silly.
If you go back, it's only a year ago, right? So a year ago, 30th of December 2022, their price was 134 per share. Now it's 699. So he's basically going, I've earned the right. You're up 5x pretty much just from there in a year.
But
So
they,
you're
from
up
when they first
5x.
float, but they did
I'm.
float at 800. But I think you can see it's zooming up, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't know why. This is weird actually, because I'm on the same Google chat as you. I'm pretty sure that's wrong. They didn't float in 2021. I think they may be, because they've been around for decades. And they've gone up and
May
down
have
in
just
price.
changed what market they're on.
Yeah, the Google chart is wrong, because I've seen the MicroStrategy graph loads, and that they had a huge pump and dump back in like 30 years ago, and then they've just been and they for decades they were pretty.
Oh, here we go. Yeah, on Yahoo Finance, they were somewhere about, oh yeah, 98. They flew up to, God, 1390, and then it massively dumped down to what have we got? 70, is that right? 1730? Yeah, 1730. And they pumped back up to, I think when Bitcoin was booming up to near 800, then we've had what's gone on. So yeah, you're right.
Yes,
They've had a
that
pump
chart
and
was
dump
wrong, yeah.
there.
But yeah, they are still down on all-time high, which makes sense because Bitcoin's not at all-time high. So the chart I've got here, they peaked at 1,000, and they're back to nearly 700 now. So yeah, it's about the same as Bitcoin, right? Where they're still about 30% off the all-time high. So is Bitcoin. But it's a genius way of picking buying stocks, right? Or buying Bitcoin because say it's just he's obviously his share price is pumping so hard. His shareholders are getting so rich off his shares. He's going, I'm taking some of those gains for myself and I'm going to dilute you. You're going to lose like 7-10% of your shares, but you're still hugely up. So don't worry, you're still hugely in profit. And I'm buying more Bitcoin because I want to get 210,000 Bitcoin. I want 1% of the Bitcoin supply in MicroStrategy. And I don't want to take lots of debt. It's kind of a pain in the ass. So I'm just going to dilute my share price. Create a load of shares out of thin air, literally use the money printer and create fake money into real Bitcoin, and then shoving that on the balance sheet and going, there you go. And yeah, I wish I could do that, freaking buying Bitcoin, just diluting shareholders that I don't give a shit about, but I'm not Michael Saylor. And it's probably the only time that I would agree with diluting the share price, because I'd be pissed off if anyone was doing it for any other reason. But if you can dilute me just to buy more Bitcoin, shove it on the balance sheet, I'm like, you know what? Short term, that sucks. Long term, I make more gains. Dilute me is all you want, bitch. So you just take me on the ride. It'll be interesting to see if he does stop at 210,000 or if he even gets to it. We'll see what the price does over the next 6 months to a year, because it's going to take him a while to get another 21,000. Although, to be fair, like, Jesus, how much is he buying? 14,000 at a time. It's two more DCAs. You probably only need another 3 months to freaking get it.
Yeah, but it's whether the price shoots way up,
Yeah.
it's going to become very hard to buy that amount.
Yeah. With Bitcoin 10Xs, then straight away, a billion doesn't buy you 14,000 Bitcoin anymore, and he buys you 1,500 Bitcoin. So, yeah. But to a certain extent, I want MicroStrategy freaking stacking for the next 20 years trying to get that Bitcoin, because but they shouldn't have that much Bitcoin anyway. It's a little bit worrying that they're going to be freaking so powerful when imagine Bitcoin at $1 million a coin and they've got 1% of the supply. Like Michael Saylor and MicroStrategy, they are going to be the equivalent of the US government. Like they're going to be so freaking wealthy. They've got 5.9 billion now, and we haven't pumped yet. What the fuck? You're going to have hundreds of billions. It's going to be the richest guy on
Yeah.
the planet by a country mile.
Be interesting though, because when that gets announced, oh yeah, Forbes, richest people in the world, and it's like Michael Saylor with 500 trillion. I'm the nearest person like with a trillion, and he'll be like, made his money for Bitcoin. And it's just like, maybe it isn't tulips. It could be a good turning point. So we'll wait and see. Because like I said, I think the next week is going to be fairly big, and then the next few months are probably going to be a lot bigger when the ETFs actually get launched and what happens from that. The kind of publicity, advertising, marketing, whatever else, which goes in and how people receive that.
Yeah. What do you, when do you reckon we'll pass 100K this year?
Oh, we said it a few shows ago. I think in the next couple of months we're going to hit in pounds, because I'm shit with dollars, about 65 to 70 grand in the next couple of months. And then I think we're going to have a bit of a fall.
What's that
And then,
March then, basically, you're saying?
yeah, March. Let's go for March. I reckon we're going to hit 60, 70 grand. Then we're going to have a bit of a fall, as things won't be moving as quickly as people think. And they'll start to just sell because it'll be leverage Bitcoin and whatever else, and just impatience and that kind of like what do we call it? High time preference.
Right. I'm going to try to be more bullish and say in January we'll bust through 100K.
I think 100K you're gonna see more like towards the tail end of the year, September, October. But
But
listen, I think
the good thing is,
we're going to see a peak. We're going to go back down, and everyone's like, oh, Bitcoin's dead again. And the ETF start to crank up. And I think September, October, when things start moving, we'll see over 100K.
Let's see. Because we had a 7% day today. It's like we need a few of those, and we accidentally get past all-time high, then it hits
And the
all
memes
these.
come out, the YouTube videos come out, the GIFs come out.
Yeah,
Everyone's
and
getting spammed with fucking Bitcoin propaganda again.
it's been long enough since all that dumb money built up, and there's some people who I just yellow in for the wrong reasons, but it all contributes, right?
Yeah.
So, oh well, let's see, eh? Let's see if we're there this month. Let's see if the ETF gets approved this month. This is, I've seen the odd rumor on Bitcoin Twitter where they've been going, these ETFs aren't getting approved. They're trying to big everyone up to make it feel like it's in the bag, get it all priced in, just to fucking rug pull us and go, we ain't approving that bitch. And so who knows? There's still that possibility in there, because at the moment, so many people just have assumed that this is in the bag now, and I'm one of them. It looks like it's completely in the bag. BlackRock have come in. Why would they have come in? Why is everyone being so positive towards Bitcoin ETFs now? They still hate Bitcoin, but they love the ETFs for whatever reason, which clearly is because they can control that one. They can't control this one. But who knows? Like, maybe they are freaking, selling us. It's a red herring, and they're just dangling it in front of us, going, "Yeah, don't worry, guys, you're getting your ETF." And then just to rug pull it and go, "Nah, it's a freaking scam. It's disgusting. It's boiling the oceans. Bitcoin will never have an ETF." Just to like really shock people and just
Yeah, I
destroy the
suppose, yeah,
narrative.
we need the confirmation, but even without the confirmation, the future doesn't worry me.
No, it's actually, I saw another chart today. Unfortunately, it was from Pomp, but the all-time high for how many addresses have one Bitcoin in them, all-time high. Hash rate, all-time high. Everything like for use case of like the real meaningful things of Bitcoin, and how much Bitcoin has moved in the last year, which is an all-time low, which is good, which essentially just means hardly anyone is moving their stack and essentially selling it. People are just, the amount of Bitcoin is just being, is the transactions are one way. People are just stacking and hodling their coins. It's like the amount of conviction in Bitcoin is just all-time high, hash rate all-time high, hodlers all-time high. It doesn't really matter what the ETF does, but I think we'd all just enjoy a bit of the bull market via an ETF.
Yeah, I'd love that. I told you so.
Yeah, we're gonna get them anyway. It's just wine, isn't it? You just gotta wait for like the fucking the pound to crash, the US dollar to crash. When they've all got nothing, gonna be a bit sad for them, but we'll have our Bitcoin. We'll be all criminals then, by the way. Yeah, we'll have to. It's gonna be quite hard to do the I tell you so's, because if you do, those people will shop you and go, oh, he's got more than $100 worth of Bitcoin, so that's illegal. He should have given that over to the ETF people. Why is he holding it? I've heard he's got a Jade. And if it can come smashing your door down. But yeah, we've got that to come. Hopefully Sailor creates his own country. We all move there where we can actually openly do the I told you so's from a safe jurisdiction where we don't get our doors smashed down. It's all coming, man. It's not going to be nice. It really is. It's almost why I like these kind of like the fake pumps, like this ETF pump is, I just see as completely fake, because clearly we know the product is garbage. But some people get to take some profit, like change their life, maybe retire, do all those things. I'm like, let's get that done in these fake pumps, because when the real one comes and fiat really does crash, you're not going to be going out buying Lambos and doing all that type of stuff, because like, this the actual real ex the change from fiat into Bitcoin is not going to be nice. Yeah, Bitcoin's going to be demonized, it's going to be criminalized, you're likely going to have to leave, move your family. And so I'm not looking forward to that time. I know it needs to happen, but we can have some fun before that all happens. That'd be nice, because the last 3 years of lockdown and all that bollocks have been pretty shitty. So if we just get if you get a nice bull market just based on a shitty ETF that isn't even real, and people get to buy a few nice things for themselves, let's enjoy it. And then maybe the
So
next.
you're making it downbeat now because it was quite positive. Yeah, we're going to end the show saying this has been a very bullish episode, apart from saying we're a bit fed up hearing about ordinals in Argentina. But
Hey,
you know.
I'm saying you can go buy your Lambo probably this year, next year, can, based on fake BlackRock ETF bollocks. So,
Yeah, but then you have to throw in the negative, don't you? So Mr. Negative Nally and Mr. All In, who's probably going to his acid rave now, telling us that things are gonna go to shit and we're gonna go to prison. So you better learn how to bare knuckle box.
I'm just being truthful on that one. I'm just saying, enjoy it whilst I'm last. If anything, it's another I told you so from me, really, which is enjoy this good time. And if you do want to sell some Bitcoin to enjoy your gains, I would encourage you to do so. Don't make good decisions financially, but I'm like, in 10, 20 years, who knows what the world is then? So if you're making 10x what you've got now in the next couple of months, I would say enjoy it. Otherwise, in
Yeah,
the
you
next
may
5 years, if we're all freaking running off to El Salvador, freaking wherever Saylor's new country is, and things are a little bit more
when your
basic.
electric car breaks down because you've had too much steak that month, and so you have to run and carry your shopping with you to go home.
Exactly, man. These freaking carbon, freaking footprint ID cards. Like, oh my God. Like, the world we're going into is not fun. It is not fun. I'm just holding Bitcoin, I can guarantee, like, you put that onto your carbon footprint, whatever your allowance is, it just goes, whoop, gone. You hold
No,
like four Satoshis, gone.
we've been through a CSG compliance, so KPMG says the world's auditors. So let's leave it on a positive. You make it sound, if anyone's actually got to this point of the podcast,
We're
make
going to
it sound really
100K this month,
downbeat.
fucking motherfucker.
Okay, on that point, I think it's time to end. So Mr. All In, who's going to an acid rave now, and I'm Dr. Evil. I'm trying my first attempt at the going out because unfortunately Sir Neverlook is ill on his deathbed, being infected by his children. We're looking forward to 100K this year. Month, even. I think that's it. Is there anything else which you want to say?
Nope, I'm out.